again, dreamers. Welcome back to the Lost in Dreams podcast. I am your host, Dylan Menzie. My guest today is a Gemini and Emmy Award-winning writer and producer. She's worked as a puppeteer on Fraggle Rock and Mr. Dress-Up, not to mention she's the creator of the iconic children's television show, The Big Comfy Couch. Let's kick into it. This is my conversation with the incredible Cheryl Wagner.
Okay.
Cheryl, thank you so much for being here. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
As usual, I am joined by my co-host, Joce Rayom, and I will start by asking, do you dream?
Yes.
Yes.
I very much do dream. I don't always remember my sleepy dreams, but when I do, they're usually startling. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's like, what?
Shook away.
No! Yes! But just to preface this, I mean, just to give you a sense of when I was a little girl, when I was 3 or 4, my eyes crossed and I had to wear a patch.
Just all of a sudden, out of nowhere?
Kinda. Mm. And I had to wear glasses. And back then, it was very unusual for kids to wear glasses. So I was always behind something, like looking at things from behind. Mm-hmm. And so what was true is that I became an enormously observant person, but a very extremely shy person. And right. Even to the point of adulthood, when I moved to PEI, I jokingly say I never said a word till I turned 30. Mm. And it's kind of true.
Yeah.
Hilda Volno would always back me up. She said, it's true. She didn't say a thing. But what was going on for me, which I think has factored into my life and all the things that have surprisingly followed, I have recently been diagnosed with ADD.
Just recently?
Well, I've only diagnosed recently.
Right.
And yeah. the doctor who diagnosed me recently with ADD, he said, you know, you're very lucky you could make a living telling stories. Because if you had tried to make a living in the ordinary world, you would have been a total failure.
Yeah.
I might have ADD. Who knows? I've never got a check.
Well, I wasn't intending to, but what happened was I was living alone, which hadn't happened for a while. And what I had to watch and see in myself was, with just me there with the dog and the cats and everything, I couldn't do one thing for 5 minutes. I was going from thing to thing to thing. And I'd even put a timer on, say, you have to do this for 20 minutes. And off I'd go into something else, you know. So it's been problematic. And, you know, there's a price I'm paying for this sort of lack of focus on things that are not right there right now.
Yeah. Well, ADD and ADHD are both like long lost inherent traits from basically primitive days. They're survival instincts. So people that have ADHD or ADD are the ones that are on lookout, that are able to do those hunting tasks that we would have had to do way back when. But since they've carried over into modern day, where we're all of a sudden supposed to focus on this one thing, then you find people aren't able to. And especially with women, it gets diagnosed usually about 15 to 20 years after boys.
Wow.
The doctor himself said, like, he had been working with children, and he said it's only recently that they're starting to really look at adults. And I don't know his family story, but he basically said he couldn't help his brother, so now he wants to help other adults. And my daughter is many things, but including she's an acupuncturist and does Chinese medicine, and she would watch me go from A to B to Z to the blah, blah, you know. And she said, you know, Mom, I have adult patients who have been diagnosed with ADD and they have medication and it's made a huge difference, you know. So I thought, well, I guess I should go find out.
I got diagnosed when I was 18, right before I left the country for college.
Oh, and ADD or ADD?
ADD, yep.
Oh.
So I have ADD and my brother has ADHD.
Okay.
And I wasn't on any medication as a child, and as soon as I got into the rhythm of taking my own medication when I came up for college, my whole world flipped around. Like, all of a sudden, I was able to sit down for at least 15 minutes and, like, go through on Wikipedia and find information instead of going to look up, you know, like, some type of music theory and ending up on, like, serial killers of West India. Like, it's so...
I mean, who hasn't done that?
Yeah.
I never got a paper in on time in 4 years of university. I never did. And I'd go down into the stacks. I went to the University of Toronto, and I'm supposed to be doing this. And then there'd be something else, and then I'd be off wandering, reading about something really interesting to me, but I wouldn't get my paper done.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
When I sat with this doctor here on the island, and he had his computer out, and he just had me talk for hours about starting and earliest memories and everything, and ask me pointed questions. And when you see it all lined up like that, you think, oh my God, it was obvious, but yeah. not to me.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
I was hippie trippy. So that era, yeah. certain things you weren't, you know, I mean, yeah. I was going to go to law school, but then I knew I couldn't stand up and talk in front of anybody when I was that shy.
Right? Yeah.
Right.
So we came here instead.
Mm-hmm.
So where did you come from?
Toronto.
Yeah. Yep. What drew you to puppeteering? Was that something that happened on PEI?
Mm. It's an unbelievable story. It's a true story. Mm. Okay. We drive out of Toronto in a broken down red Volvo someone gave us with fake license plates on it. We have $100, 100 pounds of brown rice, a dog and a cat, a case of tuna, because Ron was addicted to tuna. And his parents said, we're not even saying goodbye to you because you're not getting further than Scarberia in that dump. So anyway, the further east we got, the better the car started working because it was getting trashed up and everything. Right? And I mean, there's a storybook in there for kids, which is the car that wanted to be a boat, because ultimately down the road, the engine, the Volvo engine, was taken out and put in a fishing boat. Right? But anyway, so we had $100.
And you spent it all on puppets?
No. But the other thing we had was the only time Gulf credit card ever gave a credit card out to a graduating class without asking them to sign on the dotted was that year. Mm. So we put all our gas on this credit card. We got to PEI. Mm-hmm. We rented a house for $80. We had $20 left. What are you going to do? So
right.
we actually rented to a couple of students. But at that time, Pierre Trudeau had introduced a program called Local Initiatives Project, LIP Grants. Mm. So we were trying to dream stuff up. And we had come here thinking, well, we're university graduates. It's a province. We'll get jobs. No, they're going to give their kids jobs.
Yeah.
Right? So anyway, so we're trying to think up all these ideas, kind of environmental and this and that. And finally, Ron comes running home. He says, I've got the idea. And we said, oh, yeah, what is it? And he goes, a touring puppet theater. Ron, we don't know anything about puppets. He said, well, we won't tell them that.
Yeah.
And you're really good at writing grants. So I wrote up this grant proposal. We throw it into the machine in late November, and I get a job in the post office all night where you have to swear allegiance to the Queen, which was just crazy. So finally we're going, oh man, we want to go home for Christmas. It's December, right? And we were just really our tails between our legs, and we've got someone in our house, and let's figure out how to get train tickets. This is the lowest point in my life. Mm. And I thought, if my mother knew I was doing this, she would disown me. I was like so ashamed. But we got one-way tickets to Toronto. We had 10 cents in our pocket. I made a stack of sandwiches. Couldn't even buy a cup of coffee on the train, right? It was just like, this is so bad. So it's December 23rd, something like that. And we get to Union Station, phone Ron's dad. He comes and picks us up. So we get back to the house, and at 10 to 4... the phone rings, and it's Buddy in the LIP office. So it's 10 to 5 here. And he said, I was trying to wait till as close to Christmas as I could to let you know Santa's came to town, and you've been awarded $25,000 to do a touring puppet theater. It's like $100,000 now.
Yeah.
It was like in 3 months. We arrived at the end of September. This is the end of December. So suddenly now we had to do puppets.
Right. Yeah, to figure out how to do it.
What was the show that you applied for?
Well, the program was the Local Initiatives Project. So I put forward that we would tour to schools, old age homes, bring music and live and do an environmental show. I don't even know what I said, right? So what turned out to be true, to make a long story somewhat shorter, was we had talent. We just had no idea what we were doing. So we did everything wrong. Like our puppets were really heavy and like break your arm. And we had a puppet stage that was a wooden box so we could put everything in it. But it was heavy and you couldn't get it around the corner and you should have had cloth. And I mean, we didn't know what we were doing, but we were really liked by the LIP grant people because we were very visual. You could take our picture, put it in the Guardian.
Right.
I was absolutely a vigilant Virgo and made sure all the reportage was done right and all the, you know, I was very good at that kind of thing. So anyway, but what happened was a friend we'd made, her name's Allie Lou Curtin, and she was vice president of the Puppeteers of America.
Mm-hmm.
And so she came to see our show and she said, "Oh my God, you guys, you're so talented and you don't have a clue. You don't know what you're doing."
First call out.
So she encouraged us to attend the Puppeteers of America Festival that was coming up in about 2 months that she was heading up. It was in East Lansing, Michigan. Mm-hmm. So being the good grantsmanship person, I applied for Canada Council. And we got to East Lansing, Michigan. And in 1 week, we saw 60 puppet shows and learned as much from the bad ones as the good ones.
Yeah.
It was my first encounter with Jim Henson. Like, we got to ride in an elevator with Jim Henson, the king, right? So that was the beginning of that. We did it for a couple of years, but it was difficult hiring friends who were gifted and talented and everything, but they might not have the same work ethic.
Mm.
So having to fire friends and all that.
It's hard, yeah.
But anyway, it was decided Ron would go to Acadia and take early childhood development, and we'd sort of combine our children's theater with education. So we moved to Acadia. And while we were there, we got pulled into Nova Scotia School Television and doing puppets and television.
Cool. Where does it go from moving to Nova Scotia to Fraggle Rock? And do you remember the moment you found out you got the job at Fraggle Rock?
Oh, yeah. By the time Fraggle came along, Ron got very bored about just waiting around. So he sort of dressed himself up as the puppet, which was a clown. And off he'd go. And he wouldn't come back all day because he was having the time of his life. And it really suited his very outgoing personality, right?
Mm-hmm.
What ended up happening was the marriage didn't hold. And ultimately, we separated and he moved back here and blah, blah. And I came to visit, and a friend ran up to me with a newspaper saying Jim Henson's auditioning in Toronto.
Mm.
I was like, oh, boy. So I thought about it for a day or so, and I thought, I've got to tell Ron.
Mm.
Now we're flying back to audition for the King, right? So we get to CBC, and it's a cattle call. There's like 300 people there. It's just wild and crazy. So they decided to do it alphabetically.
Holy
Wagner. Yeah. So we're there all day. And they had people go in three at a time because they just had to. So Ron went ahead of me in the
lineup,
in the three ahead of me. And then he comes out and I go in with two guys. And there's a table of nine people and Jim Henson's in the middle. And it's just like, oh, my God, right? All these producers from CBC and Britain and everything. And Richie, who's like a Muppet guy. I can tell the way he's gotten through the day is it's gone up his nose, right? So he's really hyper and boom, boom, boom. Oh. And it's like, okay. And Richie, God love him, he's gone now. And I really loved Richie. He never loved me, but it doesn't matter. But he was one of those guys, a gay guy who always was attracted to straight guys. So he was crazy for Ron immediately. And it was like two bad boys. That's, Jim didn't need that. But anyway. So the first thing Richard says to me, Wagner, Wagner, so is he your husband or your brother? I thought, oh, no, it's all about Ron because he's also a
guy.
And out of nowhere, I said, well, he used to be my husband, and now he's my brother. And that whole big table laughed, and I went, I just got a job.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Aside from that, what was the audition? Did they have you working puppets? Or
they gave us puppets, and they wanted to hear what accents we could do.
Mm.
They had us do, and we might have sung and see if we could lip sync to a song that they provided, a few little things. They had our resumes there, and I had done television because of Nova Scotia School Television.
Yep.
there was a professionalism I could bring or some experience. And also, I think that one time much later, because I got to be Jim's preferred right hand, so I'd do his right hand while he was doing this, like, yeah. You know, so I'd be there. So one time we were waiting for a light to change and we were waiting forever. And I said, so what do you think your best talent is? Because he had so many, right?
Yeah.
And he said, putting together the right team, which surprised me. That's right. A producer's response.
Yeah. Yeah, that is a very important aspect to any creative work.
Ron didn't last long because Jim just didn't need two bad boys. Ron had arrived.
So he got the job as well.
Well, 10 of us were selected originally because they needed that opening sequence. Mm. But what happened, which was terrifying, was we'd moved up. And having worked in television in Nova Scotia, I knew what puppeteers got paid, actor minimum. Well, yeah. Henson didn't want to pay that. So all of a sudden, we were in this very protracted situation with actor negotiating. And so they had this very dragged out kind of 6 weeks where they'd pay us $100 a week to come to do a workshop. And we were really competing with each other to see who's going to get a job.
Right.
So we did the opening sequence, you know, that with all the puppets in the world, all the Muppets in the world kind of thing, all the Fraggles in the world. And then they let two people go. And one was Ronnie.
Have you ever had a dream that has changed your worldview?
Well, changed my worldview. That's interesting. I mean, my dreams have shown me things about myself for sure. For like, I have a recurring dream, two recurring dreams that are basically actor's nightmare kind of dreams. One is that I'm informed that I have to write a calculus exam for grade 13 exams. And I'm going, but I've got a BA from the University of Toronto. They said, it doesn't matter. You signed up and you have to. So it's that kind of tension of having to deliver where you're not expecting. And then the other one, it's always funny, is like, being told that I'm in the orchestra and I have a flute solo, and I'm going, but I don't play the flute. And I go, yes, you do. Oh, you joker. Now get on out there. You know?
Do you actually go out and play the flute, or what happens? Does it end before you get on stage? Or
I think I go out on stage and I'm looking out, and then I always wake up. I don't sort of humiliate myself and trying to blow a sound through it. But
Yeah. And do you ever interpret your dreams? Like, have you ever looked into the meaning?
Oh, well, I certainly see performance anxiety in those two dreams, but where I do interpret is I do have a recurring dream that's gone on for years and years. I dream that I all of a sudden remember a forgotten room in the house, and it's often behind me to the left, not always, but it is beautiful. It's like, and the housing that I'm living in can be varied, but there's this forgotten room, and things are covered in white sheets, and there's really beautiful furniture, and it's just like elegant and simple and light, and it's like, oh, I forgot about this room, and I'll forget I had it, and all of a sudden I remember, you just had that dream again, that kind of thing. But for me, what it's about, and this is where I interpret it, it's about the part of me that's been neglected.
Right.
Right.
Covered and unused and forgotten about and not gone to, and it's been there and you haven't accessed it. Right.
It's always, it always has been there.
Yeah. But
when you open the door to this forgotten room, is it dark?
No.
Is it light?
It's light.
Yeah, right. And it's big windows.
I never
windows
have had to turn a light on, actually. That's funny. Okay. I never thought of it. But no, it's light because it's got beautiful windows.
Mm.
And in truth and in fact, I've always been a dreamer and not a doer. So even the puppet thing, Ronnie dragged me into that world, right?
Right.
And when I had Dan and Ron was turning into a clown, well, Paul Hewson stayed for 6 months and those boys went on tour.
Mm.
But then Paul's partner arrived from the Yukon or whatever, and so they were going to go off and make their own theater company. And we were in Nova Scotia, in Halifax, so it was now my turn to put the clown nose on, and I didn't know if I could do that, you know, because I was so shy. But I did, and it was fantastic for me because I got to look the kids right in the eye and I got to be really there. But it wasn't something I pursued. I wasn't the doer. Mm. I got sort of pulled into it, and it proved that I was gifted in that department. So obviously what came from that after Fraggle, I worked in television. I worked on Mr. Dress Up as well. And I really wanted to write for them. They didn't want me as a writer. They wanted a puppeteer. And I was like, oh, I guess I'll do that. I'm so glad I did because I love that guy.
Yeah.
But Canadian talent that I met working on Fraggle, once it ended, Rob Mills, he and I became friends. And he wanted to be a TV producer.
Right.
That's what he wanted. And I had an idea. So it was sort of like I coupled again, business-wise, with someone who was really driven, where I was the kind of, I dreamt it up. So what I had...
You were the Steve Jobs of, what's his name? Wozniak?
Yeah.
We used to, it'd be funny, we'd go to meetings trying to talk about this project with Owl TV at the time, and we'd go to this bar afterwards that had a huge fish tank. We'd sit right by the fish tank, and it had like piranhas in it and stuff, and they like, bam, against the side of the glass and everything.
God.
Yeah, it was crazy. And we go, yeah. And Rob would go, we're producers. And I said, so am I Zero Mostel or Lidjack? Which one am I right here? Rob had an encyclopedia knowledge of silent film and comedy.
Mm.
And Karen, who I put together with him, is a brilliant visual designer. And so putting our skills together, we could make a very attractive package to go forward.
In that package, you're talking about the Big Comfy Couch.
Yeah. So I'd brought all my experience. And they weren't parents, okay? And I was. And so I had a sensibility for preschool that they had no idea because I was a mom,
right? You've got this real life experience.
And how the show was born, actually, was a friend came over to do her laundry in my basement. And she taught. My kids both went to Claude Watson School for the Arts. And she taught there, and she said, Cheryl, I want you to dream up a show for me, a TV show. See what I can do. And she went down to do her laundry downstairs. And so I just started drawing, and in my own home when I grew up, we had a big, old, ratty green couch. So I thought, well, she's a dancer, and so she's going to want a movement show. So I thought, oh, up off the couch so they won't be couch potatoes. And I drew a tall beanpole with blonde hair on it, and then I put great big glasses on it, so lunette, like loony, but lunette being glasses, right? So by the time she came up, I said, yeah, I think I've got something here. And so she went home, and I kept working. I just was, and so the next day I said, okay, do you want the good news or the bad news? She goes, I don't know, I guess give me the bad news. I said, you can't be the star on this because you're 36 and it's got to be a kid on the couch and you teach at Claude Watson. There's so many gifted, brilliant kids there. She goes, well, what's the good news? I said, well, there's a granny, you know, and you could be the granny. And her mom was famous for fracturing English, right? So she could sort of base it on her mom, right? So anyway, that's where it all started. And I was hoping Harmony would want to, because she'd been born in a trunk and she knew everything about clowning, and but she didn't want to be working for her mother, right? And that was brilliant because we went with someone who had a lot of TV experience, and she was short and round, and I knew her mother, and her mother was only that big, so I knew Allison wasn't going to grow taller, and, you know. So anyway, that's where it started.
Wow.
Yeah. So you just immediately went to clowns because of your experience with them, or
Totally what I had learned by clowning. Well, E.E. Cummings has a beautiful definition of a clown in a poem, and it's totally alert and miraculously whole. And what I learned by clowning and being right there with kids live was that they would share so much because you had one foot in their world, that you really were saying, I see the world the way you see the world. But they felt so safe, and the things that would be revealed and shared were very touching.
Yeah.
I just went with what I kind of knew. And a clown is an innocent in the world and is about total presence. They're totally, absolutely in the moment. And, you know, obviously television you're not because you have to, you're in television. But Allison talked to the kid at home, as we called it, like that direct contact through the lens and everything. And also the other thing was, I was working on Mr. Dress Up, and the art department would send art up to the studio for the story that he would read. All the kids were either blonde or had red hair. And I said to the producer, So my kids are in school in Toronto. I got to tell you something. My son's the only blonde in his class. Mm-hmm. When we got to the point of really designing big comfy couch, and I realized my first iteration was the skinny blonde girl sketch. And I went, no. So both Molly and Lunette have black hair, and that was intentional on my part because that's the world.
Yeah. Have you ever had a lucid dream where you realize that you're in a dream and you have control over it once you're there?
I haven't necessarily felt in control, but I've really appreciated realizing this is a dream.
Right.
I dreamt, but it was like it was real, that I heard a noise that someone was in the apartment with me.
Mm.
And that I could hear their footsteps. And I was like, I couldn't breathe. I was so terrified.
Right.
And all of a sudden I went, wait a minute. This is a dream.
Right.
This isn't happening.
Yeah.
Good.
And then so did you stay in the dream at that point? Or
no,
did you,
I woke
you
up.
You woke up. Okay.
And I was really glad, you know.
Yeah.
But I haven't been someone who, I mean, some people I know have really chased that, like to really travel with dreams like that.
Mm.
And I haven't really pursued dreams that way.
When you were writing for The Big Comfy Couch, what were the main themes that you were trying to get across to your audience? Did it change every week, or did you have like a general kind of, oh, we're always going to touch on this and we have to make sure that we have this? What was the process of writing those episodes?
Well, each episode had an emotional theme and a social emotional theme, we'd call it, and a physical theme.
Right.
So we'd try to see how to tie those together. So if no means no, and that's the social emotional, when you say no, you mean no, then the physical would be shaking your head.
Right.
And playing with, doing tricks I can do with my head kind of thing, right? So we always tried to have a physical theme and then a relatable social and emotional theme. And it was an interesting process to put yourself through.
Yeah.
However, one thing that was true was that Lunette always had to, 99 out of 100 shows, she went and stretched on the clock rug stretch.
Yeah.
So this was,
I was going to bring that up too, but yeah.
Yeah. And a promise is a promise even to yourself. So sometimes she wouldn't want to, and she'd crawl off towards it, and Molly would tell her, you go, you know. And Molly, of course, only thinks in pictures, right? And that was my absolute intention for all the kids. There are something like 70 languages going to grade one in Toronto. Like most kids going into the Toronto school system, English wasn't their first language. So I was making Molly someone they could totally rely on.
Accessible.
Yeah.
Wow.
And years and years and years later, just a couple of years ago, I ended up back at the University of Toronto because I was one of eight people who was an alumni of Influence. It's really a fundraiser they do every year. But anyway, it's a great big dinner at Hart House, and they have music and they have your picture up on the screen and everything. And so again, it was alphabetical. So there I am, Wagner, I'm at the end, and they have you come up and they do a little presentation and blah, blah, blah. And then you walk off. And I stepped off the stage, and a parade of young people, my sister from afar watched, she said it was so beautiful because they were now in their early 20s, and they were, some of them were musicians there and some of them were servers there and everything. And they came up and they had to tell me what the big comfy couch had meant to them. She said it was the United Nations marching up to you.
Yeah.
And saying, well, I didn't even speak English, and we'd watch Big Comfy Couch and we knew what Molly thought, and you know, and it was just,
oh,
could I have
so
my
sweet.
Oh, it was brilliant. And could they have their picture taken with me? And I went, well, sure, I guess so, right? Well, my mother will be so happy. And it just went on. It took me an hour to get from the stage back to my sister. It made it all, because you do television, you don't know the impact. It goes out there and there you go, right? But to hear their stories and what mattered to them. And then what was lovely was Rob and Karen had a party two nights later because I was in town and invited a whole bunch of the Comfy Couch crew and pals and everything.
Oh, sweet.
So I could tell them, like, we did something, guys, you know?
Yeah, reactions. Like, the ones that you form when you're a kid, they tend to kind of amplify as you get older, and seeing those people, like, I can't remember what their name is. There's like a group of three.
Sharon Lawson Bram.
That's it. Yeah, exactly. So I've heard them do interviews where they say that people come up to them in tears and just being like, oh my God, I can't believe it's you. And it really brings back so many happy memories. And just from an innocent point in their life, they cherish those memories so much.
And they were so wonderful because they truly loved children. We'd be at the Vancouver Children's Festival. And Sharon and Lois say, do you want us to take Harmony and Dan? Like, they were little kids, you know. Well, you do your show? Really? Would you? Oh, yeah, sure. You know, yeah. Raffy, he didn't want to have anything to do with kids. He wanted to be somebody else, but he was making a living doing kids' music.
Mm. What's your opinion on kids? You love them?
They're more fun than grown-ups.
You know? Oh, yeah. I always say that kids know so many more things, but just don't have the words to say it. Mm. Don't have like the clear, concise point, but if you're really listening, you'll be able to figure out what's going on.
Yeah. When you were writing for The Big Comfy Couch, were you trying to write themes that, or not even themes, but were you writing jokes, or were there any aspects of the show that were intended for adults as well? Or was it all focused on kids?
Well, this is how our writing process worked. Rob and I would sit on the big comfy couch because it was in the office. We'd sit on the couch and our feet would almost touch across, right? And we'd come up what we called with silly ideas without a home. And we'd put them on Post-its and we'd stick them up on this big board. And sometimes we'd laugh so hard. And when we laughed so hard, we fell off the couch. We'd go, oh, the broadcaster's not going to go for that one, right? But we always wanted the grown-ups to laugh, too. So we'd have silly ideas without a home, and we'd just plaster them up there. And then you'd start to see emerging themes. You'd see, oh, if that went with that, then that could be that kind of thing.
Right. Cool. Do you have any favorite episodes of the show, lessons that you were like, wow, we really nailed it on that one?
It's funny because by vetting them now, I'm looking at them with a different eye. Rather than content, I'm the critical, you know, especially starting at the beginning and moving on out. And like, and to finish at 513 today, and we did more, like that was 65th and we ended up doing 100, right?
Yeah. So, I'm sorry, I don't think we were recording when you talked about episode 513.
Right, so that was called See You in My Dreams. It starts with Lunette. I really appreciated it today because it's well-crafted, and I thought it was the last episode ever, right? And so there were things in it that were important to me, but Lunette wakes up and she's had a dream and she can't understand it, and Molly's being Dr. Freud, sitting there writing it all down, so that's really cute. But I think, actually, my favorite one that I feel was so important and we did such a good job was called Full of Life. The physical stuff was about being full and empty, so we could play with things filling up and emptying, but what it really was about was trying to come to grips with the fact of impermanence and death. And it wasn't about grief. It wasn't about, I'm so sad, or, you know, I'm missing someone that matters to me. So what happens in it is Lunette goes out to Granny's garden, and there's a caterpillar in it, in the garden, and it's a cute little caterpillar puppet and everything. She loves it and everything, and they get busy doing stuff, and then she comes back, and the caterpillar is dead. And so she doesn't understand, and Granny explains to her, she said, well, it was full of life, but now it's not. And then Granny sang a song, sometimes you have to say goodbye, I'm sorry, but in the end you'll be happy again in good time, right? And they bury the little caterpillar. And so it really looked at that things can be full of life and then they can be empty of life, right? Yeah. And other things can be full and they can be empty. Well, oh, my heart, the feedback we got on that show. I'm going to cry just thinking about it. A journalist from Detroit, I think, he wrote an article about how his family had watched this show and what it meant to them as a family, because he had just recently lost his mother, and they sat as a family because they had very young children on their couch and watched this. And he said, it gave us a way to talk to our very young children. He said it meant the world to them as a family. And there were other, like, it was before email, you'd have to get things in the mail, you know. But again and again, people commented on what that show meant to them. So, you know, so it wasn't all silliness. And even though the song, you know, the place where silliness never ends, the theme song says that. But we really made attempts to address things kids would deal with.
Yeah.
Like one show was about Lunette not being invited to the boys. Bedhead and Snickle Fritz were having their boys club, and she wasn't allowed, and like what it feels like when you're not included. So we did approach emotional, social issues that for little kids are very complex and very present, and they're learning all about that, and it's a big deal.
Definitely.
And all of us are working hard to be totally alert and miraculously whole. Yeah. That was a kind of beacon for me. We would get letters saying, your clown isn't nice. She gets grumpy. Like, we would allow her the full realm of emotional experience, just like any kid. But she ultimately had to apologize, and she had to understand, and she had to learn, right?
Yeah.
So it was about becoming a human being.
Yeah.
But people give us a hard time. It'd be pretty funny.
Oh, yeah? How so?
Well, she was rude. Kids are rude, but she didn't stay rude.
Yeah, you know? She learned. Yeah.
Well, you never knew what you were going to get. I mean, the public can be so odd. And one time we had a show, I think it was first season, and Molly was feeling so small. So it was about someday you'll grow or something, and got a letter about my grandson, he's got this condition, and he's not going to grow, so you shouldn't say that. And it's like, oh, gee, I guess we can't say see you later if there's blind kids watching. You know what I mean? Yeah. It was just, it wouldn't stop.
Yeah, I mean, most kids are going to grow.
Yeah.
So going back to the making of the staff, after having talked with Jim Henson about how important that is, how did you kind of mold your staff with the big comfy couch?
Well, initially, the most important thing was the casting.
Mm.
So Allison had worked with me on Mr. Dress-Up. One day, I just looked at her and I went, Allison.
Mm.
She's looking at me like, what? And I'm looking at her little plump round hands, and, you know, she's a teenager, and I'm going, oh, Allison. She goes, Cheryl, like, what is your problem, right? It was just obvious. Allison was it, right?
Yeah.
And obviously, Granny Garbanzo was Grindel because, I mean, she had done some clowning and she was a dancer and she was the best singer on the show. I mean, she just had every talent there was, right?
Yeah.
She's just fabulous. So I had someone else in mind for Major Bedhead. And the reason being, his name's Tomasz Kubinek. I don't know if you know his work. He's fantastic.
I don't.
But he's a theater guy. He didn't have any interest whatsoever in working in television.
Mm.
Like, no way. He's a theater guy. So Rob said, well, Fred's a juggler, and he'd studied dance, and he'd done this, that, and everything. And I was like, well, I guess so, you know. So anyway, we were kind of playing games, just fooling around in a studio, and Grindel and Allison with just the two gals. And then we brought Fred in, and I just gave them situations to goof around in, right?
Yeah.
And I literally felt that I had been pulling the big comfy couch up the hill for 2 years or whatever it had been now, right? And I felt it pass me by. And it was like, this is chemistry, and you cannot buy chemistry. And it was so good. So we didn't think we'd get funded, right? Because we were new. We came out of talent. We weren't experienced. We were aligned with OWL TV. And so Rob, my partner through all this, got offered this great job with Henson out in L.A. working on Dinosaurs, that body costume show that was, you know. So he signed that, and he was going out west, and all of a sudden we got the news that we had full financing and we had a TV show to put, and it was like, I have to do this by myself. I mean, I was terrified. I didn't know what I was doing, right? All of a sudden, like, he was leaving. He was furious, but he couldn't tear up his contract with Henson, right?
Yeah.
But we found a really good production manager, and for quite a while, the big comfy couch was in a spare bedroom in my big old house in Toronto. So we got things going. Rob's gone. We've got an office. We've hired Moira, and she's great. And she had produced, she's a production manager, but she'd produced her own feature film. It had been at TIFF and blah, blah, blah. So anyway, I've got the couch in the bedroom, and it's so big you can't open the cupboard door. So finally the couch has to leave my house, and we're getting ready and everything. And I open the closet, and I see this jacket that I'd forgotten I had, and I really liked, right?
Yeah.
So I decided, oh, I'll wear that gray jacket today. And I reached in my pocket, and in it was a ticket to a film I'd seen at the Toronto Film Festival. And it had been very odd because I was with Johnny Hopkins at the Toronto Film Festival, and he convinced me to crash a press only. You know, I hate crashing anything, right? So we got in there and we got to see this film. And I found it hysterically funny, right?
Right.
But I was the only one laughing because these were all press people, yeah. right? Yeah. So anyway, I go to work and I say to Moira, she goes, oh, I like your jacket. And I said, yeah, I haven't worn it forever. I said, and I saw this film, Rumors of My Death. She goes, oh, my God, you saw that? She said, that was my film. She said, it was, I thought I was going to die. She said, but thank God there was one laugher in the group. And I went, that was me. And so that's where you start to feel like there's kind of an invisible hand of fate.
The string that somehow connects a lot of people.
Yeah, and brings us together. Yeah. We can't understand that. It's just one of those magical things. Anyway, so she put together a very good crew. But it was a very interesting process for me. I was the dreamer, not the doer. Mm. And right, sitting there having to be the producer.
And being the doer
having
after
to
all
be
those
the doer.
Years, yeah.
Two things happened. I insisted that the very first time Grindel, Fred, and Allison went on camera, not to have them as their characters, but to have them in this little storybook black and white thing of the old country where they were different characters in MOS and without having dialogue.
Right.
So they could play together in front of a camera. The old performer in me went, this is a good idea.
Yeah, just being comfortable with each other. Yeah.
Yeah. So that was one thing. And then I started to realize Wayne wasn't getting the coverage. He wasn't getting the close-up. The shot should be on Molly thinking about what Lynette said. He's not getting the shots. And I didn't know how to say, I don't think you're getting the shots, right? Because I'm not a director.
Yeah.
But then I realized he was pushing so that by Friday we were done at 5. And it's like, we've got everybody till 7. I need those close-ups, right?
Yeah.
So it was an essential thing for me to stop me hiding.
Yeah, taking more of that role.
And yeah, the being the doer and taking responsibility. Because being the cross-eyed observer my whole life, the shy girl who never said anything, just watched. So Rob, he finally finished working out in L.A. And he got to come home for the rap party. For the first season, and it was like he got a producer's credit, and I mean, we did post together and everything, and he was so angry at the shots, and it was just like he wasn't here at all that stuff.
Yeah.
What can you do?
Yeah.
Did you ever talk with Jim Henson about the Big Comfy Couch?
No, he had died, I guess. I'm just trying to remember. After Fraggle ended, there was a big gap between Fraggle and Couch, and I was doing Dress Up, I think, and so, no. He was a very focused guy. It was funny because I'd be attached to him and waiting for the lights to change and everything, and he wasn't someone where you could really have much of a conversation. Didn't, I remember there was some big, something happened in India, there was some terrible news and people got blind and everything. He didn't know a thing about it. He wasn't really, he was very focused on what he did.
Yeah, totally engrossed in his own world.
Yeah, he really was.
And but I guess as a creator too, you do get sucked into your own world like that.
Well, he had so many things that were, I mean, there was us all in the studio, but all the business stuff he was dealing with all the time, and the whole Disney thing and being bought out by Disney, it was getting kind of messy out
there. Yeah. But I do have one more question, which is, why do you think we dream?
Well, that's interesting. Why do we dream when we're sleeping?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I watched See You in My Dreams today, right?
Yep.
And one of the things was Lunette was going around interviewing. She was deciding she would interview and ask people about their dreams. So she went into Granny's cart and Granny was dreaming about Boyd's. So Lunette asked Granny, why do we dream?
Hmm.
And Granny said, well, you have a very busy day and so many things happen. And I still have this prop, but it's three blocks that you can twist, so there's four sides. And so she said, so you have all these different ideas. So she'd twist it and so it'd be Snicky's head and Bedhead's body and somebody else's feet. And you're trying to organize it, but there's so much information in your head, so you're just trying to put it all together. So I think there is that kind of sense of filing.
Mm.
That said, there's something so extraordinary about what can get triggered and where it can take you when you're dreaming, and the things that come together that seem so disparate. But if you really follow it and find it, you'll see that it makes sense. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I might have ADD because all I heard was Lunette came up with this podcast before I did.
That's Lunette did.
Yeah, exactly.
She loved being the reporter with her little...
Yeah, exactly.
She was going around asking everyone about the dream. And then Bedhead arrives and he's sleepwalking.
Really?
Yeah.
You know what? That was going to be my next question. Are you a sleepwalker?
No.
Yep, it was. Yeah. That's really weird.
No, I'm not a sleepwalker. No.
Thank you so much, Cheryl, for coming in. This has been really, really awesome.
Oh, and, thanks. I enjoyed being with you guys.
Can people follow you on whatever, or are you just, you're
well, I'm on Facebook and I'm on email, but I don't do Twitter,
social media.
Instagram, any of that?
Yeah, because I just spend my whole life there. I just fall in that rabbit hole. I spend too much time on Facebook as it is.
I did see that the Big Comfy Couch was on YouTube, though. So if anybody wants to go and see some episodes of the Big Comfy Couch, you can do that on YouTube.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I should tell you that my big dream for a long time, in terms of Big Comfy Couch, is to make a feature film.
Yeah.
And I'm working on a script, and it's called Comfy and Joy. And it would be an evergreen, you could watch it forever, and it has a kind of... Yeah. So anyway, I'm having fun dreaming up Comfy and Joy.
New,
awesome. Well, I can't wait to see it when it's finished.
Yeah, me too. That would be a dream come true.
Definitely. All right. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And thanks for listening, everybody. We'll see you next time. Dear dreamers, thank you so much for listening. You can rate and review this podcast on Apple Podcasts, and don't forget to subscribe to the Lost in Dreams podcast wherever you're listening from. Make sure to check out my Patreon at patreon.com/DylanMenzie to find out how you can get access to bonus content, merch, music, and more. Every dollar is so appreciated, so from the bottom of my heart, thank you. This show is produced by yours truly, and the music is from my newest record, Lost in Dreams, which you can stream anywhere right now. If you have a dream you want us to know about, send me an email at menzie.dylan@gmail.com and your dream could be featured on the show. Thank you to the Canada Council of the Arts for supporting this project, and I'll see you next week.